And it's not about this bit. You ready? It's about this bit.
Oh, cool, cool, cool.
I'm just pulling apart Cal's beautifully constructed lights here.
If anyone's going to pull apart my lights, it's you, babe. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the best party ever! He is the world's first time traveling DJ, building his unique global identity 10 years ago by playing massive chronological sets from the 50s to today. He's rocked the biggest festivals in the world, from Tomorrowland to Coachella to quite literally the largest shows in the history of the Edinburgh Fringe. Please welcome to the garage the phenomenal Hot Tub Time Machine!
Doof, doof, doof in the air tonight. Music from home never felt so right. Now your neighbor's awake in the 3058. It's Coburg up late.
That was great.
Hey, baby, how you doing?
Hey, I'm really excited. I've noticed that you've just called me baby. Is this a new thing for you?
I'm on tour at the moment with a singer by the name of Mr. Brendan McLean, who's a wonderful, beautiful man. And all we do the entire fucking show is call each other baby and darling. So I'm in that groove right now. And it's good to see you, bro.
It's good to see you. Too. This has been a long time coming. I feel like we first touched base probably back in season two. It's season five now. And for you, you are touring the 10 years of Hot Dub Extravaganza. You played at Northcote Theatre last night. How was it?
It was wild and joyful. Beautiful theatre, I tell you what.
Three really good adjectives, by the way.
Back in Sydney, that venue would have been turned into apartments a long time ago. We would have got the fuck rid of it. We would have made it a Westfield. We would have made it Toys R Us or like some kind of pokey den. But here in Melbourne, it's rejuvenated and become a bloody beautiful venue to play in. So I had a joyful gig last night.
Am I detecting some anti-Sydney rhetoric there?
No, I'm pandering.
Thank you.
Melbourne get fucked. I'm a Sydney guy, but I'm pandering to the crowd.
Well, I think we could probably even do maybe two steps beyond Melbourne is your recent show at Printworks in London in October. I was very, very privileged to be privy to an incredible two-hour YouTube video that I believe you cut yourself.
The Tomorrowland one I did myself. Printworks, I paid
someone
a shit ton of money to do that for me.
Well, it shows. It looks great.
But I micromanage it. There's no part of my show and my that I will not micromanage to. So that poor guy, I gave him a whole spreadsheet of notes. No, that I think that camera could you could cut to that three frames later, and then we'll get that into there. And then
you sound insufferable.
Yeah. It's the little things that make that make the difference.
Tom, I swear to God, I see myself in you so much. Like this poor camera team rock up today. I'm sure they really want to express themselves creatively, but this Nazi over here, like no, spreadsheet here.
It's one of the great joys and challenges of being a creative person is also is having a vision.
Yes.
And pushing your vision.
Yes.
Not being a cunt.
I'm out.
but knowing what you want, because everyone wants to make your art better. You know what I mean?
And so you got to,
I think I've learned over the decade of doing this now is that it's no good complaining after the fact and going, oh, that should have been that way. If you don't give people direction,
sure.
If you don't tell people what you want,
sure.
Then you can't whinge about it.
Sure.
So, yeah, I just try to tell people what I want.
And you've been honing that over the last 10 years. Can you tell us a bit about what the original Hot Dub vision was? I mean, I mentioned in the opening monologue that you're the world's first time traveling DJ.
Mm-hmm.
I think there'll be maybe 100% of people that aren't aware of you
will
be very, very perplexed by what that means.
I DJ in chronological order, which is my gimmick. And it came about in like 2010 and 2011. I was always a vinyl DJ. No one would give me gigs, but I was exclusively playing in bars and in my bedroom, just on vinyl. I never got into these. And then...
Which is amazing, by the way, because I saw him warming up on these and the cunt knows how to DJ better than half the people we have here.
See, I dropped the C-bomb earlier. Now you're getting involved.
Yeah, you've made it
appreciate
okay.
You're an empathic man.
Yeah, that's right, baby.
You're an empathic man. I respect it.
I just pick up what you're putting down, baby.
And so, yes, I discovered Serato, so I didn't have to drag my records around. I was doing like the Melbourne Comedy Festival. That was my niche. The video plugin for that came out. I was very influenced by a guy called Sampology from Brisbane,
cool.
And DJ Yoda in the UK, and I started making a video show. And then... out of
what
that.
What year is this? Just for
this
reference?
Is 2011.
Okay, so 11 years ago.
Yeah, I guess it was New Year's Eve, my birthday at the end of 2010 when I did the first video show, Tom's Video Dancerama, it was called.
Yeah, yeah. Not and quite as distinct as Hot Dub Time Machine, but no, I like where your head's at.
It was very mashup heavy, yeah. As was the era, very early YouTube, very Charlie Bit Me cut over a freaking, you know, a hip-hop track and then me hitting cue points and stuff. And
wow.
It was fun and my friends liked it. But after the show, my friend Jordan from Axis of Awesome came
shout
over.
Out, Jordan.
Absolutely. And I'll never forget it. She came up and she said, you've got to, this is good, but why not have a story? Why not have a narrative? And
wow.
Then the following year, I was doing the Sydney Fringe Festival. I got asked to do that, which was great. And they wanted me to do my video thing because they'd seen me do it at the comedy festivals.
Yep.
And I just couldn't write Tom's Video Dancerama on the fucking sign-in sheet. So I needed
it.
Yeah. And I heard Jordan's voice in my head. And I thought, oh, let's get this a story. And so I decided to make it a time traveling thing. That would be the theme, that it would be about time travel. And we'd tell the whole story of music.
Wow. So, had you not had that early tap on the shoulder by a collaborator in Jordan, perhaps you would be a lot more straight down the line DJ. Maybe this is an example of the you need to have a vision, but it's also okay to accept guidance from other people.
Oh, absolutely, and it's all it's a remarkable. Now looking back, 10 years is my 10th anniversary tour. Looking back
Happy
on this
birthday.
Career. And life that has come about, it seems incredibly fortunate. But basically, what the chronological thing gives me is is different. You, as a DJ, you've got to be different. There are so many people doing this.
The exact same thing.
You have to be different.
Yeah.
And so that is my point of difference. And as a creative person, it gives you a framework, which I think is really important. Anything creative you do, to put boundaries on it. If you sit there and just go, I'm going to make something cool, that doesn't work for me. I need to have a structure.
Yeah.
And also the chronological thing, it just fucking works, man. You like start with old music and you build up energy. I'm big into storytelling in DJ sets. I'm big into energy rises, which I know all DJs are, but I take that very fucking literally. Because so you're starting with the old show, we start with like rock and roll and disco, and then we end up with EDM.
1954 with Rock Around the Clock.
Yeah, baby.
Why is that? Oh my God, this is good. I'm actually getting a little turned on by all the babies.
All right.
Why Rock Around the Clock for an opening song?
Why not? It tells the whole story. I really wanted to do 50s rock and roll. I wanted to represent that. And it's literally called Rock Around the Clock. So the show
it.
That is about rocking around
actually,
the clock.
Sorry, I've literally just made the connection. I feel like a complete fucking idiot. Although I'm sure you actually dictate that. Tom, I had the privilege of watching Hot Dub Rave Machine probably maybe 3 or 4 months ago now at the Timber Yard. That was a fantastic show, but it seemed to be somewhat of an evolution from you on vinyl playing rock music from the 50s. It seemed as though you'd, I'm not going to say upgraded, but you'd changed your tune a little bit and you were suddenly playing on CDJ 3000s and you were playing dance music from 1991 to 2022. What inspired that?
I've always been a raver. I've always loved dance music.
Yes.
I was like, I had a...
And I love that about you because I think a lot of people prior to Hot Dub Rave Machine maybe wouldn't have necessarily picked up on that. They would have been, he's a music fan. But this guy's a fucking dance music tragic.
Yes. And it very much came first. I'm like a born-again lover of pop music. I used to be a ridiculous techno snob.
Really?
I first started raving in the late 90s, discovered ecstasy, abandoned heavy metal, and was very into your trance. Everyone gets into trance initially. And then I was very into techno. I loved Speedy J, Ben Sims, that kind of tribal 2000 sound.
OG.
Mate, Speedy J. Some of the best times of my life, Ben Sims, Tribal Tech, because it's my kind of guy too, like 4-deck vinyl, beat juggling, like intricate stuff. It also coupled with my love of hip-hop turntablism as well.
Wow.
And so, yes, a rave machine, I kind of wanted to come back to that after, and I wanted to make a show that celebrated dance music. I tried it before on the Serato setup with just the 2 decks,
right.
And it wasn't fun to me. I didn't think it was good enough.
Why? What do you benefit from by having a CDJ 3000 as opposed to Serato?
The benefit is you can have 4 of them. That's the only benefit.
You can't do that with Serato?
So it's another thing. Everything I do has to have visuals.
I
will never, ever do a gig without visuals.
Okay.
Again, you've got to be different.
I hope I fulfilled your rider today.
When you... you got to be different. And so that's my big point of difference is that everything I do has... And it can't just be like a logo spinning. It's got to be completely synced visuals.
And it definitely can't be a logo static. That'd be fucking boring.
No, baby. This is a different thing.
Hey, we've upgraded. See, we've gotten close. It's only been 10 minutes. He's calling me bae already.
You're talking yourself down, baby.
Oh, thank you.
So I wanted to do 4DX and I wanted to sync visuals. With Serato, there is a hard cap on two. I spent a long time trying to design a 4DX Serato visual setup. And in 2020, I was going to go back and do Tomorrowland Clang and do that with a 4DX Serato setup. I'd made it so we would have like you'd do it on two laptops.
Yeah,
so you'd
yeah.
have one and then link it all through Ableton Link and network. It was unbelievably complex.
Oh,
I was going to use the Rain 12s so I'd still have the spinning platter.
Yep.
And it was going to happen. And then COVID happened.
That's
and
so
then
disappointing.
I came to my fucking senses. And also they evolved the technology of... Show Control, which is the time code protocol that you can use for these, so you can sync it up better. It now links natively with... Oh, now look at this is nerdy shit.
Let's get nerdy. That's what we're here for.
It links natively with Resolume in a much tighter way, so you can do very, very tight visual shows across 4DX. And when I'm doing dance music, because I want to mix... I want to have more... If I'm doing dance music, I want to have 3 or 4 DX. It's just what
cool.
I want to do.
Cool. Do you want to do some dance music with me today?
Yeah, let's stop talking. Should we play some tunes?
Yeah, absolutely. We have Hot Dub Time Machine here all the way from Sydney. It's an absolute honour. And actually, just before we kick off...
I forgot we were going to play music. That was just a conversation.
That's nice. That's
different thing.
That's, yeah, we're entranced.
We just love the sound of our own voices.
Yeah, I'll speak for yourself. I mean, I definitely do.
I love the sound of your voice.
Oh, likewise, back at you, man. You know, in fact, actually, most artists that we have in here, we actually have to turn up their microphones. Cunt's got good mic technique.
Mate, well, as I was saying to the lads, I used to mix TV shows. It was my job to sit in
really?
A Pro Tools room and mix people's poor mic technique,
oh,
my friend. So,
and what's your vibe? What's your read on the situation today?
It's good. I'm concerned about the audacity.
You need
to upgrade that.
It's actually quite audacious to use audacity.
Are the mics on separate channels? That displeases me. I'd like to see them on separate channels because I feel like I'm louder than you.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, well, I mean, we can mix that there. Amazing. This is. Hey, by the way, if you're actually watching this on YouTube right now, it's because Tom slid into my DMs a little while ago. He goes, get that shit off Vimeo. Get the backstreets of Vimeo put on YouTube. So that's thanks to you.
Well, I'm a big fan of my girl Yo Mafia, who is another visual DJ, and it's a small community of visual people. And you had Marf on, and I watched that and very much enjoyed it, and have been following it ever since. And now I've met you, and you're a lovely man.
Oh, back at you, man. Okay, now we're going to do a chronological set today.
Yeah, baby.
All right, fantastic. Are you happy to start in 1991? Because that's all I've prepared for.
This is one that I haven't actually. When I was making the rave set, I really always imagined this would be in, and then it didn't quite come out, but it's...
Oh, this
I
isn't,
feel like
this,
it this,
this isn't in the rave set?
No, it's not in the versions that I did at the gigs. Like,
sure.
When I was putting together the rave, I made like a spreadsheet of like, I'm so ridiculous with this shit. It has like...
I know you are, it's
350
amazing.
Songs in the year they were made, and Where Love Lives by Alison Limerick.
Now, Tom, you said earlier that you wouldn't wear a party hat because it's early in the morning, but now that we're on camera, would you wear this party hat?
Yeah, sure, Cal.
Happy 10 years to Hot Dub Time Machine here on Coburg, up late. And that was the party hat. We did it. Take it away, my friend.
It's actually one of those classic... classic things that whenever if you ever go to a photo shoot and the photographer's like, could you maybe just put some headphones on and go like that? Like, no, I'm good, mate. It's not 2010. But also I'm aware that no one fucking asks. There's a certain type of DJ people that ask that of, you know what I mean? Like, no one's asking Richie Horton to fucking put a headphone on and go like that. And I know I'm not fucking Richie Horton.
I get the impression that's always been a chip on your shoulder. You're like, I get it. I'm the kind of DJ that you ask to do that.
Now, be aware that I do edits. So you have...
No, you're playing two tunes though.
Oh, am I? Okay,
yes, sorry. Yes. Now, be aware that you have two tracks. We got Hot Dub Time Machine, Mr. Tom Lowndes, here on Coburg Up Late. It's an absolute honour and a privilege. Happy New Year. Happy 10 years. Happy life, baby. See, I'm calling the viewer baby now.
Hopefully they turn to each other and they start calling each other baby now. We can start a baby pandemic.
What a time. Now, this is definitely is in the rave set. I was always going to do a hot dog rave. Now, I have an a cappella to put over the top of this, baby.
Sick. I have noticed watching your print work set the other day, there seemed to be a lot of edits, like a lot of pre-production had gone in. Oh shit! Okay, can we talk about this? Can we nerd out for a second? Are you? We've got the instrumental on your right deck, and on your left, you've isolated just the vocal? That's fucking cool, Tom.
It's so you can control it and make a... Yeah, I like to make things tricky.
Hey, Tom, what year are we in currently?
This is 94, mate.
Okay, so I've got to do 94 and beyond. But you, do you still need these? No more.
Insomnia already, Cal? Wow.
1995!
At least warm me up a little. Talk dirty.
This is
what version is this?
This is it's a much more recent version, so I'm actually breaking the system very slightly. It's like a kind of a modern techno edit of Insomnia.
See, one of the rules I put on myself is that I don't play remixes unless that remix is iconic.
Yes, and this is not an iconic remix.
There is absolutely no reason to ever play a remix of Insomnia.
Okay, have a go at this. Let's challenge that. Hot dub time machine. Let's see if we're proven right or wrong here.
Of course, I just mean with my set and my DJing, baby. There's nothing wrong with people playing Insomnia remixes. In the context of... my thing. That is,
Tom's trying
quite
to,
nice.
Tom's trying to micromanage me.
It's quite nice.
Bad, huh?
It's okay.
It's just like a crisp edit, right?
I got a thing that, like, I reckon in 2022 or 2023, if you're not using sync, then you are. This one isn't linked.
Yes, so these two are linked.
Oh, okay.
So you can sync.
This is the There's a whole thing, oh, like, oh, we don't use sync. However, I'm going to look at this and then I'm going to line this up. And somehow that makes me a better DJ than someone who presses the sync button.
That's true. That's an interesting discussion in itself, isn't it?
It's fucking garbage.
I actually only recently realized that one of my favorite DJs on the planet, Mr. Guy J from Israel, hang on. That he uses sync. And that blew my little mind. But I realized it just frees you up to actually make creative decisions.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's about knowing the technology and using the technology. And it's, yeah, there's a weird dick measuring thing that goes on in dance music about it, and it's a nonsense. All right, you know what?
So right now you have a longer dick than me? Or actually what you're putting
is... No, I'm saying you do, because you don't use sync.
I don't use sync, but I've got a longer dick, but you have a shorter dick, but you're more okay with the length of your dick. Whereas, as opposed to, I'm insecure about the length of my dick, which may or may not be longer, evident by the fact that I don't use sync.
All right, mate.
All right, babe.
In that case. He said not to touch the gain, and then he touched the gain. This one is for you, darling.
I've just seen what you've done. Fucking brilliant. Very well done. Just stroke your ego. That was incredible. The timing was amazing. Who has a short dick man just on command?
Who doesn't? What a fucking banger.
Aspiring DJs, you've heard it here first. If you don't have short dick man just literally in your pocket ready to go, do you even DJ? Of a DJ, like a rap battle?
The DJ battles are a thing, my friend. Have you watched David Rodigan clips on YouTube?
You've got to cross
David Rodigan?
No, give me some homework, please, Tom.
I'm not even using headphones. I probably should. How do you use these things again?
Wait, who's driving this thing?
This is an underappreciated track. Club hopping, club heads. See, I like finding the tunes that still sound great, even though this is the original 1995 version.
I think what sounds
clean, doesn't it?
It's clean. I think it's that hat, right? It's the hat which makes it really fucking dirty.
It's the minimalism, my brother.
Are we still chronological? What track's this? What year is this?
It's about the era. It's mid-90s.
Mid-90s. Fantastic. We're in the mid-90s. Forget what you think. You know, it's mid-90s. It's probably 1997. Here in the garage in Coburg.
This is like 95 still-ish.
Oh, nice. Okay, here, cool. Man. So we're technically still chronological. Let's pretend Short Dick Man came out then too.
Now this is my shit. Underworld. Underworld. Playing this at Printworks was like legit one of the highlights of my life.
Mate, that's a good question, actually. You've played Printworks, you've played Coachella. You've played Tomorrowland. You've played literally the biggest events and festivals and clubs in the entire world. My question...
That is incredibly untrue, but I appreciate it.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess I was about to ask, where do you go from here? But it sounds as though you have even loftier goals, Tom.
I kind of want... Yeah, well, at the moment I'm trying to pivot into the dance music world. That's where I'd like to be. So
consider yourself pivoted.
I love Tomorrowland and I love that whole thing. I want to do more. I want to just hitch my little carriage to the EDM train without actually playing EDM. Here we
go. Hold on.
See this? Do you know this track?
No, I don't.
This is Cowgirl. This is an all-time classic. And it's not about this bit. You ready? It's about this bit.
Oh, cool. It's all about the bits here on Coburg Up Late.
I'm just pulling apart Cal's beautifully constructed lights here.
If anyone's going to pull apart my lights, it's you, babe.
All right, what are you going to do? We're in pretty dark, techie territory here.
I'm obviously going to answer the brief abysmally.
I saw Underworld at the Big Day Out in maybe 03, and it changed my life. It was so great. Mainly Carl Hyde's dance moves. It's big shapes. When you're playing a big room, you got to throw big shapes. You are pulling this off. He is pulling off. Cowgirl into Mouse T. I want to see a backspin on Cowgirl. There you go.
I do what I'm told, Daddy. Okay, we're in 1998 now. It's a classic by house maestro Moose T, who will be here in Melbourne on New Year's Eve, I believe. You might remember this, Tom?
I'm horny all night long.
We've gone from cowgirl to horny.
Are you really not across DJ battles as a part of reggae culture?
No, I'm really actually not.
Oh, my man.
Reggae, now, I've got to be honest. Actually, just a moment, Tom. We've got to respect the drop.
So, yes, I'm going to butcher this explanation, but sound system culture... As a part of DJ, like, so I love, I'm so fascinated by DJing as an art form, as you know.
I love that. I love that about you.
And all aspects of it.
You're quintessential nerd in the most beautiful way.
Yeah, it's not just about hip hop. It's not about techno. There are other DJing as a culture has all kinds of different roots, and one of those roots is sound system culture from the Caribbean, and sound system battles are a delightful part of the thing, and it is about song for song. And you get more and more credit depending on the originality of your dub plate. Now, a dub plate is a track that you have a name check in.
So that you what, sorry?
It has a name check. So if we were having a proper battle, this would need to have, like, Coburg Up Late in the lyrics. You would have had to go on into the studio, re-recorded this with Mouse T or whoever the vocal is, and put it... I'm singing with Callum for you. And the crowd would be like...
Is this the official, unofficial name check now is you acapellaing over the top?
So you got to look up David Rodigan on YouTube.
You heard the man. Quit this episode right now. Get out of it. Oh my gosh, I can see. Look what you've done, Tom. This is literally visible.
He's devastated.
It's visible in the shot.
He wants everything to be perfect, but it's not going to be perfect, Cal.
It's not, is it?
That's just fucking life, my brother.
That is true, isn't it? This is what happens when you collaborate.
All right, I want to play something different. What's something I don't normally play?
Yes, the stage is yours.
You know what? This is an underappreciated track that I tried to get in this set many times.
Do
you know this song, I Will Love You. It's not what you think it is.
Can't you see I don't need you? Oh. I mean, I was going to say it's Fatboy Slim right here, right now, but you've got a new vocal going on. Me down. I turn my back in your... Now, is this your edit?
No, this is a track that came out in like 1998-ish.
Great. Oh, wow.
It's called In and Out My Life by One Big Fat Diva. And it was on a Danny Tenaglia mix CD, Global Underground London, which is one of the greatest house music compilations of all time. And just check it out, brother. And it's all about this breakdown. This is going to be in a Hot Dub Rave 2.0 because you can do some really interesting things with it. And this bit right here, check it out.
Oh, wow.
Hold on, Cal. Hold on, Cal. I want to see you lose your shit, brother. Come on.
I gotta say, I've never had a guest in here lose their shit more than me, but I think you're giving me a run for my money, mate.
Just what I do, baby.
Sounds like a name check. Hot Dub, ready? Hot Dub! Now they'll do it again.
Of course they won't do it again.
$19.99.
I see a lot of cue points. You do a lot of pre-production, don't you, Tom?
Yeah, it's to me, if you DJing is about planning. Like some gigs, you can freestyle. Absolutely, I'm doing a lot of corporate gigs at the moment. You read the room, you play some shit. But when you're doing a big ass show, you need to be prepared. You need to be up there, and you need to have the freedom to perform and to be yourself and have it. And if you're up there and you don't have a cue point. You're not doing your job.
It's the equivalent of the sync button, right? By having the sync button on, it frees up your time for more creative mixing. By having a pre-prepared set, it frees up your time for more creative performing and perhaps even a new level of creativity beyond that.
But also, to me, it's like the sound system thing. To me, it's a whole other side of DJing that I really enjoy, which is the comes from hip-hop culture, the routine set. So turntables do routines. And then,
which is what you do, but in this dance music world.
Yeah, and so one of my biggest favorite DJs of all time is a guy called DJ Shadow.
We love. King. Also a big visual artist.
Indeed, and his sets are orchestrated, planned, beautiful pieces of art. And it's a real thing in the techno world to go, no, I never plan anything. I get up there and I feel the vibe and stuff like that. But also, there's an art form to making something
guys.
That's intricate. No, I mean, it's an art and a respect to it, but nothing's better or worse. It's a different side of the culture
sure.
to make something that is intricate and planned. Because you're unlocking creative possibilities you can't get any other way.
Yeah. I love that you timed that explanation with the drop.
That's what I do, baby.
That was the Bloody Beatrids 1-2 whoop whoop, but we all got educated at the same time.
I'm so bad at back-to-back. Like, my friend Pat Stevenson is the guy I most do back-to-back with, and he hates it. Because I just never give him the fucking headphones. I break all the rules.
We got Hot Tub Time Machine laying down the acapella over Mason Exceda from 2006.
2006, all right.
I've jumped forward a little bit. I realise we've got 25 minutes to get to today, mate.
I respect it.
It was a special time in house music, electro house, and this is absolutely the peak, I think.
I'm down with it.
None of that vocal edit. Straight up synth. Love your work, Mason. Assuming you're watching. You're definitely watching.
What do I do, Cal? What do I do?
Hey, Tom. I hope this is not too personal to broach on camera, but you are sober.
I am, indeed.
Congratulations.
Thank you. You too, brother.
Hey, come on.
Sober, boys.
We don't need it. Just a moment, sorry.
It'll probably be exactly 2 years when this comes out.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, 2 years, congratulations.
Thank you, man.
Can I ask how that's affected your relationship with performing? I was going to say, and music, but I can't imagine it would have affected your relationship with music, but perhaps the touring circuit, the professional aspect of your life.
I think that it's a great question, and thank you. I do, I struggle with it for a long time. I built my career and my business being the banging the fat boy slim rule of always be the drunkest person in the room and wear bare feet. And I was living my rock and roll dream. And I went on a podcast back in like 2015, and I was talking about how I actually have like this fantastic relationship with alcohol. And the guy I was interviewing, the lovely Osher Ginsberg, he was like,
from Osher to Padgham, you've really taken a step downhill, mate.
Don't talk yourself down, baby.
Thank you. What I mean is, you're on the travelator up, baby.
he was like, yeah, I'll see you in a couple of years, and he was absolutely right.
Is he sober as well?
He has been sober for a long time now.
Wow.
And he's kind of was a big help to me. And I think that in this industry, everybody has to reckon with it at some stage. When you start out, you want to party like you're 21 the entire time. And
it's not sustainable, is it?
It isn't. And particularly when you have a family.
Shout out to the Hot Dubs.
I got a thing I want to try here, actually. It'll get us into the 20... Oh, no, we've got more time for 2000s.
Fuck yeah.
But yes, I think I DJ better now. It took me a long time to make that transition.
So it wasn't an instant flick of the switch?
No, absolutely not. I went to AA for a little while, which I found very helpful. And then I came off it for like maybe 4 months. And then I went back on it. And I just always found I was getting... I'd be right for a while, and then before you know it, I'm at a festival in Fiji, and I'm going out into the crowd and taking every drug that's handed to me. And
more, please, more.
It was, and then I'm at home with my kids, and I'm not being a good father, which is very real. I'm very sucked.
Yep.
And so I kind of would go up and down, and then COVID happened, and that's where I really.
Really,
because I did the live streams, so they were a real phenomenon. But
you had, I think, 12,000 people tuning into it, one live stream.
Yeah,
right? Incredible.
Yes.
So it sounds as though that COVID, that pause was incredibly healthy for you.
In some, yes. In retrospect, yes. Oh yeah, this is a break.
what we know about Tom, he loves to chat over a break. For myself, congratulations on taking that massive step, being a huge influence to so many people. I know you've been public about it before, and I know that's only done a world of difference, a world of good, not just to you and your immediates, but your greater community. So from them and myself, I thank you.
Oh, my bro, that's so nice. I try not to go on about it because I also feel it's deeply hypocritical that I like my entire business is playing to drunk and fucked up people, and I got no problem with that. Everyone's life is different, and our lives as performers are more extreme, and so
totally.
It becomes a lot more real. It doesn't necessarily apply to everybody. Some people can do moderation. It's knowing yourself and understanding that can take some time, but once you do know yourself, it's a good thing.
That's beautiful. Yeah, I know when I stopped drinking, there was a lot of uncomfortable self-talk, which was probably the healthiest thing to come out of this because it was about getting to know myself. And I can say categorically there would be no Coburg up late if there was still alcohol in my life.
Congrats, brother. All right. This is a bit that I made that I can't remember the sync of.
I feel so close to you right now. It's a force field. I wear my heart upon my sleeve like.
What'd you do, mate? Deal.
I forgot to exit the loop in time. Let's see if I can do this.
So much happening live, which is super, super cool to see. Because, you know, if you're in a hot dub audience, you just watch this guy fucking having the best time ever. But so much is happening up on the decks.
I feel so close to you right now.
One of the greatest pieces of dance music ever made.
Say what you will about EDM. There was a really a beautiful time and place for music, I think.
Still is, baby. Porter Robinson.
Fuck, he's such a good producer, isn't he?
Yeah, genius. The breakdown of this is a delight. I never get to play it. Maybe let's do it tonight. Do you want to do a little 2010s number out of this, baby?
Little 2010s coming up? We'll let the breakdown happen, yeah?
Yeah. Now, this is something I like to do all the time. Pop in a loop and have a chat. Another thing that the great David Rodigan, Reggae Sound Systems, like to do.
That's called, what we do on this show as well.
It's called a speech, you know, that is all about the quality of your speech. And now I believe, Cal.
I believe.
That one of the greatest things you can do in dance music.
What's that?
Is have a breakdown and have a woman who can really fucking sing.
How do you feel about a ginger who really fucking can't?
How do you feel, Cal?
Ecstatic.
Here we fucking go! Can we get some CO2 in here next time, please, Carl?
I'll make sure to honour the rider. I really fucked up the stationary sign, no CO2. The vinyl function foiled again.
Oh yeah, but oh man,
it's not every day you get high five for making a mistake.
That's life, man.
We've moved into 2000 and oh gosh, how do I check this? Browse. I wrote it down earlier.
Wakes up.
2017 Trent Moller remix.
Oh yeah, baby.
Oh, here we go.
This is what I'm fucking talking about, ladies and gentlemen. This is dance music distilled into one single beautiful human being.
You know, Tom, that's something I love about you is that I think you normalize dagginess in dance music.
I'll take it.
We've got Hot Dub Time Machine here on Coburg Up Late. I got to say, this is one of the most fun hours I think I've ever had. Thank you so much.
Hey.
What a delight. Something has happened in between, you know, over the last few tracks, because we've gone through time, and that was the introduction of sidechaining. Now, I noticed this when I watched the Hot Dub Rave Machine show, because you obviously started in the 90s when sidechaining was certainly invented but wasn't prevalent in dance music. There's a significant quality increase in production that happens around in the year 2000, where everything suddenly becomes super compressed and you can hear the kick drum everywhere.
Oh look, sidechaining's always been around. Hardware compressors have always had that. And a lot of those trance sounds. Yeah, no, but I 100% hear. That's what I love. I love a progression. And that's what Hot Dub does is say, can I mix halfway into this breakdown?
Right, of course, of course, of course. The first
I have no
DJ...
idea what this song is, so I'm just butchering it.
First DJ polite enough to ask if they can mix in.
See, I'm laying vocal over vocal there. It's no good. I gotta wait.
I'll loop the bit without vocals. Right,
sees the vision going, cut line after line. See how she looks like trouble. See how she dances and she sips the Coca-Cola. She can't tell the differences. That's what you're coming for, but they don't wanna let you in it. You drop your bag to the floor and
see, that's what I love. That's one of the reasons the time traveling thing works so well is the sounds escalate, things escalate. It has an energy build.
It progresses
inherently in a time traveling set.
So it's like you've got miniature energy builds happening like on a microcosm within the song, but then you have a macrocosm energetic build over 2 hours as well.
Yeah, man. Like all DJ sets should have a build in energy.
Yeah, I really dropped the ball dropping insomnia fucking 10 minutes in, didn't I?
No. It was beautiful, baby. Don't doubt yourself.
Mate, you should be my therapist. You've told me not to doubt myself 3 times now. As of this season, I'm officially big up in myself. Good job, me. Camel Fat, this track, it did a lot for tech house and propelling tech house into the mainstream as well.
One of my favorite DJ sets of all time is Camel Fat at Creamfields 2021. It's on YouTube. It is indescribably good. Like, to me, it is like just as perfect as house music gets. And I look at these 19-year-old mashed kids from the Midlands of England off their heads on pure MDMA. And I'm like, how do you have it so fucking good? They have like pure fucking MDMA imported from Holland. They're listening to incredible sounds, some of the best house music ever made on sound systems the size of an apartment building. When I started raving, okay, we had fucking pills that were stomped on by bikies. We were in a shitty nightclub in King's Cross listening to fucking Tom Wax play Communication on the speakers about the size of that fucking thing.
And this is what you get, everybody.
And people say it was better in the old days. They got no fucking idea.
We got Hot Dub, Time Machine here, Mr. Tom Lowndes. It's been awesome. We got 10 minutes left. What year are we in? Colin, this would have come out about 5 years ago.
Yeah, it was 17, I think. So that's where you're
at. So you've got another one after this.
Well done. See what he did there? It was like he didn't have a song. He's like, oh, you got another one after this.
I do have a song. I've got a great tune from 2022 coming up.
Oh, 22. Okay. And this is one of my edits, so I have no time. You know what? I'm going to do, I don't care what year we're in. I just want to play this song with you, my brother.
Oh, I love it.
Because
she can't tell the difference, yeah. That's what you're coming for, but they don't want to let you in.
There we go, baby.
You're asking what's happening. It's getting late now, hey now. Enough of the arguments. She sips a Coca-Cola.
This is your edit. You're very proficient in the last minute loop.
Yeah, I use the function a lot. Where I'll embed a loop in a track. You know, you can do that in Record Box using the...
I only found that out, like, last week.
Yeah, I do that quite a bit. I haven't done a lot of these songs, but it's a really useful function. Yeah.
I'm going to hassle you for that after the show and how to do
it's
that.
It's in the other loop system.
It's on Record Box, right?
Correct. It's the only software you can do it in. Serato won't do it. I think this is a perfect bit of dance music. I just... adore it. And doing it in London, I got because I made all my custom owned visuals for that show, and I had this incredible dancer, Sophia Narbaugh, who's like a friend of a friend, and she does these incredible African style dances, and I shot this video of her, put on the big screen at Printworks, and I'm there going, fucking, this is, my whole career has led up to this moment, and I'm very happy.
And it's all because I heard you say,
you film all of the stuff for video for your screens as well.
Look, let's be real. A lot of it I just ripped the fuck off YouTube. However, I'm trying to push my art, and so for the ratio, I made all my own, a lot of my own custom content.
That's what I heard you say.
He said, do I want to hit the whole track? I never want to hit the whole track. One verse, one chorus, we're out.
That was the verse and the chorus.
And so this might have an auto loop in it. We'll see. Actually, no, this cue point is to show you when the vocal ends and when it's a good time to mix in.
Oh my God. He's thought of everything, fellas, and ladies, and everyone in between. With Hot Dub, Time Machine. It's quite dirty, actually.
Trying to work out what other songs I never get to play that I should play.
Well, I'm moving into 2022 now. Have you got a modern banger to close with?
I kind of do, but I also might just play something.
I love that. Now, on these beautiful CDJ-3000s, I noticed that I was a semitone flat, and I've literally just nudged it up to the same key, which is an incredible, incredible tool.
Depends on the song.
Let's see if it works.
Oh, this is a tune, dude. Oh. Oh. DJ, be kind to other people. Dominating. Shredding. Send it, Cal. Send it, brother. Oh. He's warmed up now. He's warmed up now. Go, brother. That was fucking tight, my dude.
Oh, look, I had to make up for the...
I want to see that, an edit of that, and I want to see it on the reel.
Ah, let's do it. Look, obviously in the spirit of playing, you know, classic pieces of dance music today, it's 2022 is obviously too soon to pick a classic. However, beware, it'd be this. Bourne extended remix of Transmission by Elke Klein, who I hassled in a booth in Berlin about 6 months ago.
Sweet flex, bro. That was beautiful, wasn't it? Did we all enjoy that flex? I loved it.
I'm just trying to talk myself up, you know.
Do it, baby. No one else is going to do it for you.
Hey, take us home, man. Give us another tune, hot dub style.
All right. Now we have 3 minutes and 51 seconds left.
I'll give you as long as you want.
I am obsessed with finishing sets on time. I did Splendor in the Grass the first time in 2014, also a sweet flex. I'd finished my set time, and I went into my encore, which is We Found Love. And there was already, I knew that time was up, and I just fucking did it anyway. I looked at the crew and I just did it because I was a young punk. And after the show, the stage manager came up to me and he was like, mate, great show, but you cannot fucking do that. This is a festival. You're on a stage. You're on the mix-up tent. You can't just go 5 minutes over because you think it's a fun thing to do. And
was it a fun thing to do?
It was just such a real bit from this veteran crew member who I desperately wanted to impress, and I took it on board.
Oh,
and
cool.
And so I'm obsessed with always finishing exactly in time. Now, this is my 2022 song. It's by my friend, a Sydney legend by the name of Hayden James.
There's another flex for you.
He is a lovely man, and hopefully someday you will have him in your garage.
Yeah, can you just do a personal endorsement now?
Low-key, one of the greatest DJs we have. He has spent a long, long time. He's a bit more known as producer these days, but he spent so much time behind a pair of CDJs. This is the final song on his most recent album. It's called I Wouldn't Let You Down.
And the final song with Mr. Tom Lowndes, okay, Hot Dub Time Machine. I can't thank you enough. It's been such a wonderful hour.
My dude, it's a pleasure. I'm glad we got to do it. I've been playing this at every kind of rave show this year, like, and I think it's time for me to let it go. But it's written. He wrote it about a friend of ours who was our man at both of our agents in the UK, a guy called Ben Kaweza, who passed away in 2020. So it's always an emotional thing for me. One more time, my brother.
Rest in peace, Ben.
Man, it's been an incredible year, and this is a joyful way to finish it off for me. I'm sure this will come out next year, but this is the end of 2022 for me, and this has been a delight, man.
Hey, man, to be honest, actually, it's been such a great episode. I think I might open the whole season with it, so this will probably come out in, like, first week of Jan.
This is the ending of this. Just let it go. This is Jem Cooke, who also sings Breathe by Camel Fat.
I know where you came from. You traveled so far. I wanna be near you wherever you go. All I have, I will give you. I need you to know.
Gotta land it.
And he certainly hasn't let us down today. Thank you so much, Tom.
Remember, whatever you do, may you do it with passion. And may we all truly endeavour to be kind to each other, the world around us, and ourselves. I've been DJ Be Kind to Other People with Hot Dub Time Machine.
All right.
Play nice.
Play nice. All right, okay. You got it.